Hi, welcome to GRVO TV, G's Reviews, Views and Opinions. Sorry for the lack of videos recently, I won't go into reasons why, however, I'm back. And some big news, well, certainly in the camera world anyway, big news. I had a moment of, I want to say clarity, but it's more like madness, and decided one day to sell all of my full frame Nikon camera equipment, and I did. I sold my Nikon D610, the 70-200 2.8, the 24-85, the 15-30, the 51.8, the lot, the bag, the flash, everything. Sold the lot. Now, there's several reasons why I've decided I did this, and one of the reasons was the lack of ingenuity being shown by companies like Nikon, and Canon are just as bad, I think, if not even worse, in that they're relying on their sort of loyal sort of fans just keep buying their cameras, but they're not really innovating like the cameras I've chosen. The companies like Sony, Olympus, Panasonic, are the, you know, Fuji as well, are the ones I would sort of pick out as the real camera companies that are pushing forward at the moment. So that was reason one. Reason two, I like to try different things, and I've seen lots of people, you know, say, oh, you know, I've gone mirrorless and I've gone micro four thirds, or I've you know, downsized for whatever reason, and all different things. It helps with my videoing, what I've chosen, it fits my needs better. Weight is a big issue. I was away in the New Forest, and lugging around a full set of full frame gear, it's really no fun. It's different if you're on a shoot and you're doing pro work, or if you're doing paid work, it's a completely different issue. When you're trying to enjoy yourself, carrying around big gear is no fun at all. And it's all very well having a small backup camera, but you always want your best gear. So I thought, well, if I could incorporate my best gear into a smaller kit, then surely that's a good thing, and it's better to be have you all your gear with you than not at all. I was getting to stage where I was leaving lenses out and just taking a few bits with me and things like that. So what did I buy? Well, this now is essentially my full kit. I can get, this is a LoPro 100 slingshot, I think. It's the smallest one they do. I can get everything I need in here. I can get all my sound equipment. I can get two camera bodies, all the lenses, my zoom microphone, everything I need. I can get it all in here. And to me, that's wonderful. And it weighs nothing. I mean, at the moment, I've just got one camera and a couple of lenses. I've got one more lens to come. I'm filming now on my new, what I call small camera, which is an Olympus EPL5. And there's a few reasons I got that, but I'll go into that perhaps in a later video. But we'll concentrate on what's in here for now. So let's open it up. And this is what I decided to go for. Now, the cameras I looked at were the Fuji X-T1, but I did like that, but I'm not happy with the lenses. So I decided to go for a system where I can use my small camera and my big lens camera, same gear. So it was then down between Olympus and Panasonic. And I looked at the Olympus OM1 and the Panasonic GH4. Now, the Olympus OM1 was absolutely gorgeous as cameras go, but it didn't fit my hand. And it's silly things like that that you, when you see it online and you see the specs and you see these videos, you can't tell, but it just didn't feel comfortable in my hand. It the grip didn't feel right. Absolute beautiful quality and a lovely looking thing, but wasn't right for me. So I then picked up this, the Panasonic Lumix GH4, and as soon as I picked it up, I felt comfortable with it because it felt a bit like a digital SLR. It felt like my old Nikon D5100. It looks nice. Looks a little bit like a bridge, sort of a cross between a bridge camera and a digital SLR. I've got it here with the grip on it, and I just thought, yeah, love it. Autofocus is insanely quick on both of these cameras. The I won't go through all the specs in this video. I'll do a video about it later. I want to tell you more about why I've chosen this. Now, a lot of people have, and all the reviews I've seen have said this is a video camera. Essentially, it's a really good video camera. We know that the GH3, it's used in productions. The GH4 is even better, 4K video, yada yada yada. But I'm not so interested in that. Although there are some features that I really like when it comes to the video. But what I wanted to see was, is if I could use this as my main stills camera. And my thinking was, well, if it can crunch 4K video and it can do it really well and do slow-mo and all the things that it can do in video, when it comes to stills, it's going to be like, that's easy. It's going to be fast. And it is. It's insanely fast. I don't think I could run the buffer out if I tried. The JPEGs are gorgeous. I tweak them very slightly, but I'm not shooting RAW with it at the moment. I really see no reason to, because the JPEGs are that good. There's loads of detail. You've got 16 megapixels. Yes, I know there's a smaller sensor, and we'll talk about that in a minute, but the 16 megapixel sensor I sort of know and love from the GX1 that I had. It's a very similar sensor. This is better. The downsides. Well, there's the limiting factor is the sensor size. It's a micro four thirds sensor, so we've got a double crop factor. So for instance, this 12 to 35 lens becomes a 24 to 70, and this is the Pro 2.8 lens. It's a beautiful lens. So the limiting factor is that sensor. So what does that mean? Well, the actual pixel density is, I would say, on par, if not better, than my D610 that I had. And that's looking on screen, and so that's no problem at all. So you can crop in if you need to and things like that. No issues with that whatsoever. The only thing that you really will struggle with is you cannot get, because it's physics, you cannot get the really shallow depth of field that you can with a full frame and even a crop sensor. Now, with a 200mm f2.8 lens on the full frame, I can take a picture and completely destroy the background, so you just couldn't see it at all. Whereas with this, you can't really do that. Now, you can get close, and what I would say is the images I've taken so far and the pictures I've seen from it, the bokeh, the blurred background, is, although you can't destroy it, it is really nice. It's actually nicer bokeh than what I used to get off my 70-200 2.8. Now, the way you get round it is you can use your focal length to your advantage and your distance from the subject. So if you're a photographer and you know what you're doing, you can still blur the background, you can get shallow depth of field, and you can do it. So for me, that was, you know, not a real stumbling block. It was an issue, but now I've got the camera, it's not. The other issue is the autofocus. It's fantastic in single point autofocus, locks on, takes the picture instantly. It's so quick, it's unbelievable. And being able to use the touchscreen, touch to focus, etc., is, you know, it makes it even better. And also using the screen as a touchpad, so when you're looking through the screen taking pictures, you can actually use your finger to, you know, move the touchpad around and things like that, which is great for sports shooting or kids or dogs or, you know, whatever. The autofocus continuous mode is never going to be as good as a full frame digital camera or even something like the D7000 that I've got here, which is also being sold as well, by the way. Now, obviously that looks bigger with the grip on, but ultimately this with the grip on is much lighter than that. And with the grip off, it's even lighter. But yeah, that's going as well. So what I have as well is I have the grip on without the battery in it, the spare battery in it as well. So it makes it a nice, comfortable weight. It's balanced well, but you've still got all the features of having the grip. And it, for me, it works great. And I can always pop a battery in there if I need to, or I've got a spare one anyway, I can swap over. Anyway, I digress. So there you are. There were pros and cons. Depth of field. If you want to get depth of field, the easiest way I found on here is to get a long lens. Now, I bought the 12 to 35 2.8 lens. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's weather sealed. So this kit here, weather sealed, lovely. Now, I could have gone for the 35 to 100, which is equivalent to a 70 to 200 2.8, but it's a really expensive lens, and 100 equivalent 200 mil. I like just a little bit further reach. I like the 200 mil on the crop sensor. I like 300 mil as a minimum. When I used my D610, more often than not, I used it in crop mode to get that same effect. So with this, I've gone for, and I there's several lenses you can go for. There's a 45 to 150, which is a gorgeous lens. It's a metal lens and lovely. There's a, I think it's a 45 to 200. I think that's too long. There's 100 to 300. And then there's this, which is the 45 to 175. And this is the X lens, which has got the power zoom. So you can use it as a power zoom or as a normal ring zoom. You can do either. It's image stabilized. It works out as a 90 to 350, which is a lovely range. It's got nano coating on the lens. It's good optics, great image stabilization built in, and it's tiny. Look at the size of it. I mean, it's actually narrower. It's a bit longer, but it's narrower than the 12 to 35. And the other thing I really like about this, and especially for when I'm taking pictures in zoos, especially behind glass, is that the lens, when you extend it, it doesn't trombone. Like, this trombones a little bit, but no major problem with that lens. But with this lens, it doesn't trombone. It's fantastic. Now, if you take a picture at 175 at 350mm equivalent, even at f5.6 on this, you can still blur the background and get lovely out of focus. And again, the out of focus on this is beautiful. So that's my way around the shallow depth of field. Because when we're talking f2.8 lenses and f5.6, you really have to double it up. So your 2.8 becomes a 5.6 lens, and that sort of gives you roughly what the depth of field is going to be. Light gathering capabilities, it's still a 2.8 lens. So you can go 2.8, increase your shutter speed. It doesn't affect the light gathering, it's the depth of field that the crop sensor combined with that. So the effective depth of field on this at 2.8 is about the same as 5.6, so you just double it. That's roughly how it goes. So there you go. So that's my current kit. It's it weighs, you know, not a lot. It's lovely and compact. You know, you could easily get that in a tiny little bag. I've got another lens which is going to be coming soon. Haven't actually ordered it yet, but there's so many good prime Olympus lenses. I want to choose one for the camera I'm recording on, the EPL5, and I'm going to go for the 45-1.8. Now, I'd love the 17, the 12, the 25, the 45, the 60 macro, the 75. I would love all of them, all the primes, but I don't want to get into a point where I'm swapping loads of lenses. And with the kind of photography I do, the 45, which is equivalent to 90, is going to be a great portrait lens, great for blowing out the background. It's a 1.8, and it will work on the little pen, and it will also work on this. It won't be stabilised on this, but it will be stabilised on the pen, which is great. So I've got one more lens coming, and that will be my three lens setup for two cameras. I've also got the kit lens with the Olympus pen, the 14-42, which, to be honest, is fine. It is what it is. It's great for video and that. So there you go. That's what I've done. You may say I'm mad. I love Nikon. I love the D610. I love the D7000. I think they're both stunning cameras. And they're two of the best cameras I've ever owned and probably will ever own, apart from this. But you've got to weigh up what you need it for and what you're going to do with it. And for me, this is working for me at the moment, and I think it's going to work for me in the future. It's a beautiful thing to hold. It's actually more comfortable than the D7000 because of the shape of the grip. So overall, I'm very happy with what I've done, and no regrets really. Now, I'd like to hear your thoughts on it, because I'm not saying this is right for everybody. I think the D7000, the D610, the D5100s, the D800s, they're fantastic cameras. But you've got to think about what you're using it for and what you want it for. And I'm quite happy to ditch all my gear and buy new gear. And then if this doesn't work out, I'll ditch all this, sell it all, and I'll buy back my D610 if I need to. You know, I it's only stuff, isn't it? It's only possessions. You can sell it and buy it and, you know, get new stuff if you need to. So there you go. So I know I've rambled on a bit, and this will be the first of many, hopefully, videos that are coming up soon, because I'll review the camera, the lens, the video, the stills, the other lens. I've got the Olympus pen to review, the new, the 45-1.8 when I get it, etc. Maybe even the little bag. So yeah, I've got loads of videos to come, so watch out. I'm also going to do stuff on another new hobby of mine, which is road cycling. There's going to be a series of videos regarding road cycling as well, so watch this space. And this has been GRVO TV, G's Reviews, Views and Opinions. I'll see you soon. Bye.